City Morning Show.
A pleasant good morning. A pleasant good morning to everybody who's watching us or listening to us. And welcome to the Sugar City Morning Show. Es un gran gusto darles la bienvenida al Sugar City Morning Show, compañeros. Y ante todo, muy buenos días. Es un privilegio poder llegar hasta la privacidad de sus casas o de sus hogares o de sus autos con el simple toque de un botón. Pues eso es la tecnología de hoy en día. Pero sobre todo, les agradezco esa confianza que tienen. Aquí, no solo yo, pero todos aquí en Nortevisión Canal 10. Bienvenidos, compañeros. Hoy es el 29 de septiembre y son justamente las 7:04. Ojalá y tu mañana haya empezado bonito. Y aunque no haya sido así, ten la esperanza de que todo puede terminar muy bien si tú le metes las ganas para que así termine. Good morning, guys. We're transmitting live from Nortevisión Channel 10 here in the outskirts of Orange Walk Town, right smack on San Lorenzo Road. I'm sorry. And we're transmitting live. We're not on the air as yet on Channel 10. Our apologies because we had a little problems with a little storm the other day, and the problems were not so little. To say the least, but we're being viewed throughout the country, from Corozal all the way down to Toledo and San Pedro, San Bergisky, all the way across the country to Benque Viejo, through an arrangement with a network of cable providers, cable companies. Here in Orange Walk, you're watching us through Center Channel 60 and NCM Channel 17, and a number of other cable companies throughout the country of Belize that carry our signal. Good morning. It's a pleasure to say good morning. We have a good show this morning. We have an invited guest who is supposed to be coming on very shortly, and I will be discussing the latest current situation. And but before everything, we don't want to be breaking patterns, and we must begin our program with a prayer. And siempre le digo a las personas, yo hago esta oración no porque soy santo, pero porque soy un pecador, igual que la gran mayoría de personas aquí. Así que, por favor, les pido que se unan conmigo a darle gracias a nuestro Creador, porque aún no obstante lo que seamos, Él nos quiere, Él nos ama y Él nos da lo que necesitamos. Padre, te damos las gracias por tus bendiciones. Nos das la vida, nos das la salud, nos das las fuerzas. Hoy logré venir, caminar, pedalear, como sea el caso, y venir a mi chamba para ganarme la lana honestamente y dignamente, que es bueno para mí porque mantengo mi dignidad. Padre, te doy las gracias por la salud que le das a mis familiares, a mis amistades, compañeros de trabajo, a todos. Padre, te lo agradezco. También, Padre, te pido que continúes dándonos esas bendiciones, que continúes protegiéndonos, bendiciéndonos con estabilidad, con tu amor eterno, Padre, porque tu amor es incondicional. Tú nos provees y nos das justo lo que necesitamos. Muchas gracias por las experiencias que proveen para como una oportunidad de crecimiento espiritual. Padre, muchas gracias por todo esto. Te pedimos, como siempre, para aquellas personas que están pasando por tiempos difíciles, aquellas personas que están enfermos, enfermas, en los hospitales, en sus casas, o que están deprimidos en un rinconcito en su casa, no encontrándole sentido a la vida. Padre, confórtalos, consuélalos. Aquellas personas que te están pasando por tiempos difíciles porque no tienen dinero, no tienen comida, ayúdalos, Padre. Guíalos hasta donde puedan encontrar estabilidad económica. Y por todos nosotros, Padre, por todos nosotros, que podamos entender que tu amor es eterno e incondicional y que debemos de nosotros ejercer un cambio en nuestras vidas para empezar a ser dignos de todas esas bendiciones que tú nos das. Padre, te bendecimos, te adoramos, te queremos. Amén. Ya estamos listos para confrontar el día, siquiera un poco más preparados. This is the public weather forecast for today, Thursday, the 29th of September. This report generated at 6 o'clock in the morning indicates that the following. A weak tropical wave will cross the country later today and support a slight increase in moisture. My apologies. The 24-hour forecast. Sunny, with a few cloudy spells and isolated showers or thunderstorms today, becoming cloudy at times tonight, with a few showers or thunderstorms mostly over southern and some coastal areas. The winds blowing from the east northeast, 5 to 15 knots. The sea stays choppy. There are no advisories in place. And I want to quickly tell you that there is a system out in the Caribbean, Tropical Storm Matthew, but it does not present a threat to Belize. Does not. I repeat, does not represent a threat to Belize, at least not at this moment. It is projected. Although it may seem ominous and threatening if you look at it and you go like, oh my God, this thing is coming straight. It may just look that way. But it's forecasted. And I have a lot of confidence in the forecast because most everybody, the European models and the GFS models are all coinciding with one thing, that it's supposed to be going north, to be picked up north before it makes any contact with the Central American basin. So that's good to hear. The outlook for tomorrow is for some cloudy spells with a few showers or thunderstorms, mostly over the south and coast, Friday morning and night, and inland Friday afternoon. So we may just have some showers tomorrow afternoon. The temperatures, the highs along the coast, 89 degrees Fahrenheit, inland 95 degrees Fahrenheit, and up in the hills, 82 degrees Fahrenheit. The lows for tonight along the coast, 80 degrees, inland 73, and up in the hills, 68 degrees Fahrenheit. The tides, there's a high tide at 9:09 this morning. There's a low tide at 3:15 this afternoon. Then there's another high at 9:25 tonight, followed by another low tomorrow morning at 3:25. That's in the wee hours of the morning. The sun sets today at 5:43, 17 minutes before 6 o'clock. And like I said, this is going to go on until December 21st, when barely 5:30, and it will already be dark. The sun rises tomorrow, again, at 5:43, if you take a rake if you want. The moon sets this afternoon at 5 minutes after 5. And the moon rises tomorrow morning at 5:23, tomorrow Friday. We want to thank forecasters Gentle and Smith for compiling this report, and to all the other people at the Met Service because they've been up from early sending out these reports, so we in turn can share it with you, the listening audience and the viewing audience. Compañeros, muy buenos días. Un gran gusto saludarles. Hoy por la mañana, hoy es el 29 de septiembre. Si estás cumpliendo años, te envío mis mejores deseos. Muchas felicidades. Si estás celebrando aniversarios, también muchas felicidades. Siempre hay que celebrar con lo que uno tiene. ¿Ok? Este reporte generado a las 6 de la mañana indica que una ola tropical, pero bastante débil, debe estar cruzando el país más luego hoy y debe de estar causando un incremento pequeño en la cantidad de lluvia. Y no es nada significativo en realidad. Para las siguientes 24 horas va a estar esencialmente soleado, compañeros, con algunos periodos de nubosidad y chubascos o tormentas hoy, pero aislados. Puede estar tornándose nublado por momentos hoy por la noche con algunos chubascos o tormentas, esencialmente sobre las áreas costeras y en el sur del país. los vientos del este-noreste de 5 a 15 nudos. El estado del mar agitado. No hay ninguna advertencia, aún así. Comentaba en inglés hace ratitos de que sí hay un sistema, hay un huracán que está en el Caribe, pero no, repito, no representa una amenaza a Belice a este momento. Y no se espera que presente una amenaza porque se supone que está puesto a irse al norte un sistema de baja presión, lo debe de recoger y llevárselo hacia el norte, porque todavía no va a ser un huracán, y si lo es, todavía es débil y todavía lo puede, ya se lo pueden, por decir, manipular y se lo pueden llevar hacia el norte. Pero no representa una amenaza a Belice. Lo repito, no representa. Se espera que para mañana, viernes, que mañana es viernes, el fin de mes, tengamos unos chubascos, tormentas, esencialmente sobre el sur del país y las áreas costeras por la mañana y en el interior del país por la tarde. Así que mañana la gran posibilidad de que tengamos chubascos en el interior del país. Las temperaturas, las altas por la costa, 89 grados en el interior del país, compañeros, 95 grados y por las colinas, 82 grados. Las bajas por la costa, 80 grados, en el interior 73 y por las colinas únicamente 68 grados. Las mareas, una alta a las 9:09 minutos hoy por la mañana, seguido por una marea baja a las 3:15 hoy por la tarde, otra marea alta a las 9:25 de la noche, por la noche y por consiguiente otra marea baja a las 3:25 mañana por la madrugada. El sol se oculta hoy, compañeros, a las 5:43 y el sol sale mañana a las 5:43. Toma Rick si quieres. La luna se oculta a las 5:05 hoy por la tarde y la luna sale mañana a las 5:23 mañana viernes. Y le damos las gracias a los meteorólogos Gentle y Smith porque nos han proveído este reporte generado a las 6 de la mañana, para que en torno a nosotros podamos compartirlo con ustedes. Compañeros, le damos las gracias también a nuestros patrocinadores. Fielmente, German Vega & Sons, la familia Vega, el honorable señor ministro Gaspar Vega, Vegas Imports, también dándole las gracias a Hungry Man Barbecue, viernes, sábado y domingo, con buena comida al BSI Field, no se olviden, Albion's Transportation, llevarlos de donde tú quieres ir, y también Aqualife Water, buena agua, ahí en San Esteban. Y supliendo el pueblo de Orange Walk también. También le damos tenemos que reconocer esta estación de televisión, Morris y todos que están trayéndole este reporte del tiempo a ustedes. Compañeros, como dije anteriormente, tenemos un invitado, ojalá ya esté en estudios. Y vamos a estar hablando acerca de la situación actual con los maestros y las escuelas y todo el buchinche este que está sucediendo. Pero vamos primero a unos anuncios comerciales y luego regresamos con ustedes luego de esos anuncios. No se vayan, son las 7:16, vamos a este corte comercial.
Can the accommodation agreement award portion be used to fund government projects? Well, Mr. Man, no. Eamon Courtney, he did it, they said no. Well, no. Make I set the record straight. Out of all the money where the court award for BTL, the biggest amount that for the illegal accommodation agreement where Musa and the PUP they signed. When the government and Ashraf gone to court, the two sides me agree that the money from the accommodation agreement me want put in our charitable trust for fund projects for the Belizean people. But not take my word for it, the director saw in this document we signed, the Telemedia Acquisition Settlement Act. Make a read it for you. The balance shall be applied in accordance with such requests for grants as the government may reasonably make to fund projects to help the people of Belize. That clear as day. Stop listening to people with a Ashcraft payroll. The record set. Boom!
On Friday, August 26, 2016, one member's behavior brought shame to the entire country.
What is your problem, Mr. Speaker?
They pay you to block me, and that's what they pay you for.
You're going
to
tell me?
You're going to tell me? It's a joke. It's a joke.
Are Julius and the PUP ready to lead?
Sir, but you're asking for rules to be followed elsewhere. You're not following the rules.
You're not following the rules.
When was the last time you got anything free? Well, with Digicel's new improved combo plans, now everyone talks free. With free talk in every plan and even more data for the same low monthly price. I mean, who doesn't love free? Free Sundays with our Lite plan, free weekends with our Plus plan, free nights, weekends, and free calls to your circle with our Elite and Max plans, and even more free 4G data in our Lite, Plus and Elite plans. Don't have a plan? It's easier than ever with low or no deposit for qualifying customers. Still the best plans in the country. Come in and start getting more.
Expect more, get more. Always more with Digicel.
Busta. They see you and how you're living. Busta. Always a star, yes. You live in color to the limit. Busta. Large and in charge, yes. That's why you rock with Busta. Busta. Refreshing range of colorful flavors. Always a star, never the audience. You run things, things never run you. Busta. Yes, you are the life of it. Not just a part of it. Your life is never black and white. Live in full color, Busta.
You know your baby is happy when wearing Bebin Pampers. Bebin Pampers. In all sizes. Bebin Pampers. Make your baby happy. Available at German Vega and Sons.
Mr. Bresenio claims that he wants to imprison anyone named in immigration wrongdoing.
Once we get into government, we are going to go through this, and anybody that can be held criminally liable, we are going to hold them liable. And if they have to go to jail, they are going to go to jail. Enough is enough.
But even your name is there. I'm for recommending a visa. International person. I can't.
I have
but it's there in the visa one. That's my point. It's in the visa one. I think it's a. I saw it once.
I did that. I don't remember ever. Please, so many pages.
Are Johnny and the PUP ready to lead?
Let's get ready to rumble!
Get serious. Get bop.
Johnny Briseño and the PUP went to Bamapan to declare all their assets to the National Assembly. But did they declare everything? Yes, Johnny, bring back the people's money.
Welcome back to the Sugar City Morning Show. Bienvenidos de vuelta, compañeros. Tal como resulta ser las cosas, la vida está llena de sorpresas, como dirías. Azúcar, Celia Cruz. La vida está hecha para vivir. Al final del día, compañeros, todavía no ha llegado nuestro invitado de honor, por decir el señor honorable ministro, pero tenemos personas aquí que igualmente honorables, haciendo un trabajo extraordinario, porque son personas que trabajan con la gente, pero no con cualquier persona, sino estamos hablando de personas que trabajan con los ancianos, dándoles honor y dignidad y manteniendo el honor y dignidad, que es importante, porque esfuerzos espontáneos, así esporádicos, no funcionan. Pero por el momento sí, pero cuando puedes mantenerle la dignidad al individuo, ahí está. Le doy los muy buenos días a la señora Raymunda Wright, presidenta actual de la organización Voice aquí en Orangeville, y también creo que es presidenta nacional de la organización. Pero, y también le quiero dar la bienvenida a la señorita Yaneli Cantún. Muy buenos días y bienvenidos al show. Hoy vamos a hablar en español para que la gran audiencia nos pueda entender y captar. Buenos días y bienvenidos al show, Ms. Raymunda. Yo recuerdo la última vez que estuviste aquí fue casi un año. ¿Sí?
Sí.
Pero siendo la gente como son, que vemos las cosas y muchas veces no lo captamos suficiente y no lo mantenemos en memoria. Cuéntanos acerca de tu organización, Voice.
Pues muy buenos días, Mr. Manuel. Y muchas gracias por tenernos aquí en esta programa. Esta mañana les doy los buenos días a todos nuestros oyentes que nos escuchan, donde sea que estén, en sus hogares, en sus taxis, donde sea que estén. Les doy buenos días y también les pido al Señor Creador que los bendiga hoy y siempre a todos. Pues esta mañana estamos aquí porque viene el día de que honramos a nuestros ancianos. El día primero de octubre es el día que ellos son honrados, porque ese día se fue registrado esta organización como un NGO, y esta organización está trabajando abocando para nuestros ancianos. Abocar quiere decir que vemos sus necesidades de los ancianos y también los pasamos a las organizaciones o a cualquier parte donde se pueden ser ayudados. Y bastante de nuestros ancianos que vemos donde nosotros trabajamos, especialmente en los rurales, hay bastantes ancianos que sí realmente necesitan ayuda. ¿Por qué? Porque hay unos que están en cama, hay unos que no pueden dependerse para cocinar o hacer sus quehaceres del hogar, y en veces dependen de los vecinos que les den un plato de comida.
Ok, pues muy bien. Eso ya encapsula esencialmente el trabajo. Pero hablando un tantito más en detalle, ¿qué tipo de ayuda, por decir ayuda? Yo fui a ayudar, pero muchas personas se lo ayudé a cruzar la calle, aunque no quería. Pero, un chiste obviamente, pero ¿qué tipo de ayuda le proveen? ¿Ayuda económica, ayuda espiritual, emocional? ¿Qué tipo de ayuda?
Bueno, espiritual, en veces cuando llegamos le hablamos un poco del Señor, nuestro Creador, y también vemos qué son sus necesidades. En veces no tienen para comprar medicinas, no tienen para comprar sus alimentos, y eso vemos sus necesidades de ellos. Y si no están consiguiendo ayuda de ninguna parte, especialmente de los hijos, de nadie que les dé, una organización que les dé dando una ayuda como para que ellos puedan comprar sus medicinas, entonces nosotros llenamos aplicación para el seguro social, donde le dan, si califican pues esa aplicación, les dan una ayuda de $100 mensual, que se llama un
entity. Así que tú los ayudas a lograr ese
porque cuando nosotros pasamos una aplicación, nosotros lo hacemos follow up hasta ver que sí se logre okay, que ellos puedan conseguir.
Pero digamos, ustedes recaudan fondos para tratar de ayudar en casos de emergencia a esas personas, ¿también
sí,
ayudan?
Sí, nosotros recaudamos fondos como para cuando tenemos que ir a las aldeas a trabajar, pues eso también lo usamos. Y si vemos la necesidad de alguien que necesita una medicina o algo y no tiene para comprarlo, nosotros los ayudamos. También hacemos actividades que ayudan, como cuando hay, viene Navidad o algo así, hacemos un dinner party para ellos, para que ellos estén contentos ese día porque es Navidad.
Pero por decir, Voice no tiene ingresos de gobierno, nada de eso, ¿sí?
Pues
absolutamente nada, ¿no?
No.
El así gobierno que usted, el, no dinero, el dinero que ustedes gastan es porque ustedes lo dan, perder su dinero personal, o lo recaudan con ventas, ¿así
sí,
es?
Sí, así es, así es.
Porque esta, nadie les dice, toma, aquí hay $1,000 para que vayas a gastar.
No, nada. El gobierno no nos da un funding que digamos, ninguna organización ahorita nos está ayudando para trabajar. Simplemente nosotros tenemos que hacer fondos. Además de eso, cuando nos toca hacer alguna actividad como un party o algo, la comunidad nos ayuda, los businesses. Ellos, bueno, pues gracias a Dios, ellos les tocamos su corazón para ayudar a estos ancianos y ellos nos ayudan.
Bueno, esencialmente por eso se llama un NGO, una organización no gubernamental. Ajá. Porque el momento que ellos te dan, entonces ellos exigen tu plan de qué vas a hacer. Y muchas personas dicen, no, tú no vas a decir qué voy a hacer. Yaneli, buenos días. ¿Qué posición llevas tú y qué cantidad de membresía tiene Voice?
Yo soy la secretaria y tesorero ahorita.
Así que cuida del dinero.
Okay. Sí, soy la que cuida del dinero.
Okay. ¿Qué cantidad, qué membresía tiene Voice ahorita?
Pues ahorita solo tenemos una membresía de, son 8 members que tenemos activos. Ajá.
Y hay, que siempre puedes contar con ellos.
Sí, siempre contamos con ellos, cada que vamos a hacer algo, están ahí, todo. Los otros 8 que están en, siempre son members, pero no están tan active, solo como con el de la parte de cocinar, que vamos a tener alguna actividad, entonces.
Pero cuando requieras de su asistencia, por decir, siempre puedes contar con ellos, no te preocupes, yo te voy a hacer 5 libras de rice and beans.
Sí, ellos siempre están dispuestos a estar cocinando, a ayudar a decorar o en alguna otra parte que ellos puedan ayudar.
Yo entiendo perfectamente. Ahí. Dime algo, señora Raimunda hizo mención hace ratitos acerca de ir a las aldeas. Así que no se limita solamente al pueblo, sino a las áreas rurales también.
No, sabemos que donde quiera que vayamos siempre hay señores ya mayores de edad que necesitan, porque nosotros también vamos a llegar a esa edad. Así que también debemos de ayudar a los ancianos. Uh-huh. Y no nos solo para el
Orange Bar.
No, vamos a los pueblos, a las aldeas. Tratamos de buscar todo donde hay ancianos para ayudarlos.
Uh-huh. Ok, perfecto. ¿Algunos planes para este que tengas o que recién hayas cumplido que quisieras compartir? ¿O algunos planes que tienes para el futuro cercano que quisieras compartir con la audiencia?
Bueno, tenemos actividades estos 2 días que es hoy y mañana, que lo va a explicar la señorita aquí presente. Esas actividades es para, porque vemos también muchos ancianos que no salen, no los sacan de su casa, que porque se cansan o algo, pero siempre mayormente cada año hacemos actividad para que ellos puedan salir y distraerse un rato, porque tanto estar encerrada en veces eso hace que ellos se estresen, muchos ancianos, y en veces por eso tanto estrés que tienen, en veces les da ese stroke y cosas así, todo eso está propuesto para,
¿no?,
para nuestros ancianos, ¿no? Ellos entonces, tenemos 2 actividades este mes, que es hoy y mañana, que aquí le voy a pasar a la señorita que le explique.
Pues vamos a empezar. Adelante, sí. Vamos a empezar con la actividad de hoy, que vamos a tener un talk con en BHC High School, un class de Fort Farm que nos dieron para, vamos a hablar con ellos sobre en qué ellos pueden ayudar a los ancianos de su aldea. Pues pueden ayudar a los ancianos, como digamos, si ven a algún joven, ve a algún anciano que está llevando sus bolsas de compras, pues que los ayude a llevarlo a su casa, o si les puede acompañar a la tienda y que compren sus groceries y pues los lleven de nuevo a sus casas, o si necesitan cruzar la calle de un lado para el otro, porque hay quienes ancianos les da trabajo cruzar la calle. Entonces, pues los pueden ayudar de esa manera, o si pueden ir a limpiarles sus casas, o en alguna otra manera que ellos vean que pueden
también
ayudar.
También quizás, y no tendría que ser un trabajo físico, pero simplemente respetar a los ancianos.
Ajá, ese es lo primero que deben de hacer, respetar a los ancianos, porque ellos son, nuestro país está basado en ellos, porque ellos son los que estaban aquí primero que nosotros. Así que nosotros les debemos ese respeto a ellos.
Sí. Uh-huh. Eso es algo que yo veo que hoy en día, no sé por... Bueno, o sea, podría yo empezar a decir acerca de las razones, pero no es un programa para hablar acerca de eso, sino más que nada para tratar de pedirle a la gente ahí fuera, especialmente a los jóvenes, que tengan respeto a la gente anciana. Y no, yo sé que una gran cantidad de gente sí le da el respeto que merece la gente, pero porque ahí lo ves todo tembloroso con sus pedazos, con su palito andando en la calle. Si él pudiera ser mejor, lo haría. Sí.
Así es.
Pero no puede. Mm-mm. Y que conste que ahí vamos todos. Porque, como diría mi madre, no burles a aquellas personas porque ahí puedes caer tú.
Así es.
¿No es así, don señor Raymond?
Así es, porque este mundo es un mundo redondo, como digamos, y da vuelta. Uh-huh. Hoy me toca a mí, mañana puede ser para ti. Por eso nunca debemos hacer un mal a otros, porque nos puede volver a...
¿Qué te conmueve a ti? ¿Qué te mueve a ti en volverte... En esta organización que al final del día, como diría mucha gente, no me da nada, no me paga? ¿Qué es lo que te insta a ti a envolverte en este tipo de actividad? Y a ti también, Janely.
Pues míreme, Manuel, como yo he explicado, cuando yo quedé ciega, yo lloraba porque no tienes en veces esa confianza de que te van a tratar bien. No sabes qué te están dando para comer, no puedes ver nada, no puedes ver que si alguien te va a ayudar, quieres algo, no puedes ni levantarte a verlo. Y yo me pongo en sus zapatos de esos ancianos. Es cierto que muchos de ellos ven claro, pero la ayuda que con trabajo pueden caminar con esto. Y hay unos que en su silla de ruedas no quieren salir y no hay quien los lleve. Todo eso a mí me conmueve. Porque yo dije, el día que el Señor me devuelva mi vista, que Él me dé esa oportunidad de ayudar a otros que realmente lo necesitan, porque yo veía la necesidad cuando uno tiene una incapacidad, que no puedes hacer tus cosas sola.
Esa
oportunidad me lo dio el Señor al abrir mis ojos en el 2008, cuando este programa fue lanzado. Esta organización fue lanzada como un NGO. Yo me puso él enfrente esa organización. Yo entré como una miembra, yo comencé en esto. Fue que cuando serví 4 años como una miembra, cuando fui nombrada como presidenta de Orange Rock. Hasta ahorita sigo siendo la presidenta de Orange Rock. Y en febrero 25 de este año, fui nombrada la presidenta para todo el país de Belice.
Perfecto. Pues sobre todo, mis felicidades. Quisiera felicitarla por son cosas que uno debe estar muy orgulloso de una persona como usted aquí. Porque en realidad, como se mencionó, aquí no hay nadie que te diga, toma $2,000, anda a gastarlo. No. Tienes que conseguir tu propio dinero, tienes que desarrollar tu propio plan, tienes que ir a visitar a las personas, pero porque te nace hacerlo.
Así es.
No porque estás logrando conseguir uh-huh. pago.
Sí.
Y yo creo que sobre todo a cualquier persona que está envuelto en actividades de voluntarismo, Yo, sobre todo, los felicito porque yo fui parte de ello también. Gente me preguntaba, bueno, ¿y qué hay para mí? Le digo, más de lo que tú piensas. Porque al final del día, el desarrollo es para mí. Y si tú no quieres envolverte, ahí tú.
Así
pero
es.
Vas, que vas a salir perdiendo, eres tú. Yo sí me voy a cansar, yo sí me voy a enojar en veces, yo sí voy a tener que sacar de mi bolsa para ciertas cosas, pero voy a ser el beneficiado más luego.
Y al final del día usted logra esa meta, usted le logra tener a alguien contento, ser el beneficio para otras personas.
No, lo has tocado y mero. No hay nada mejor que sentirse gratificado.
Así
perdón,
es.
No gratificado, pero sentirse que has logrado algo, has logrado un cambio en la vida de alguien.
Sí.
Y ves tan de repente la sonrisa en la cara de ese individuo.
Así
o individuo
es.
Y ver que, hey, le has dado un futuro o le has dado un cambio en su perspectiva de su vida.
Sí,
y no nada más
sí.
Bonito para eso. Chaneli, ¿qué te conmueve a ti?
Pues a mí me conmueve porque tengo papás, tengo abuelos, tengo bisabuelos también, y pues no me gustaría que nadie de allá afuera los trate mal, porque tratarlos mal a ellos es como que tú me estuvieras arrancando un pedazo de mí, porque son parte de mí. Y pues sé que tarde o temprano también yo voy a llegar a esa edad y tampoco me gustaría que me traten así. So, para mí yo pienso no hagas lo que no te gustaría que te hagan. Eso es lo que yo le aconsejo a cualquier joven allá afuera, que si tiene abuelos, tiene abuelas, tiene vecinos o cualquier familiar que ya sea de la tercera edad, no los trates mal, porque algún día tú vas a llegar a eso y tampoco te gustaría que te traten de esa manera. Pero para mí tú debes de agradecerles, debes de darles todo lo que tú puedas para que así el día de mañana que tú estés en su lugar de ellos, a ti también te van a tratar de esa misma manera.
Exactamente, muy bien. Porque vemos desafortunadamente casos cuando los mismos hijos dejan abandonado a sus parientes.
Sí.
Por X razones, porque no me dejó nada la señora esta, porque me hizo esto, porque me hizo el otro. Y ese resentimiento lo cargas y no te das cuenta que más daño te haces.
Más
tú.
Sí.
Tú.
Así es. Y muchos de nosotros, en veces por eso mismo, abandonamos a nuestros seres queridos por esa causa. ¿Por qué? Porque en vez estamos peleando herencia o esto o el otro. Y nunca debe de ser, porque si tus padres, ellos deciden, pues, estuviste conmigo, pues te voy a ayudar, te voy a hacer esto, te voy a dejar tu casa para que quedes.
Okay. Pues algunos planes, a otros planes que tenemos que tomar oportunidad de
pues,
este.
Entonces también tenemos un talk, tenemos pensado en ello que queremos ya darle un talk a Louisiana School. Para que así hasta los niños aprendan también a cómo a tratar con una persona mayor. Sí. Porque desde pequeños hay que enseñarles cómo vamos a tratar, porque si no les enseñas el día de mañana cuando tú lo quieras corregir a un niño, si tú no me enseñaste eso, ¿cómo quieres que yo lo haga? Es lo primero que un niño le contesta. Y para mí eso, el ejemplo empieza desde en casa. Los padres deben de enseñarles, pues tienes que respetar a tus mayores porque son mayor que tú, deben el respeto. Porque el día de mañana tú vas a llegar a ser uno también y también querrás que te respeten.
Claro que sí.
Y también tenemos como hoy es el primer mes para los ancianos, tenemos preparado un servicio en la iglesia para todos los ancianos que quieran asistir, así que está open para cualquier hijo que quiera llevar a su mamá o a su papá.
Hoy
jueves a las 4 de la tarde en la iglesia Pentecostal MI. En la esquina de Cedar Street y Royal Palm.
Esa es la calle antes de llegar a su casa del ministro Aragón.
Ahí está la iglesia, so ahí vamos a tener el servicio para los ancianos. Y el día de mañana vamos a tener un tea party para ellos, conmemorando sus días de ellos, así que para todos también tenemos un nada grande, pero es algo que les estamos dando algo de corazón, lo que nos nace a nosotros darles a ellos, porque nosotros somos una organización que no conseguimos pago, pero los pagos de nosotros es más grande todavía que con recibir dinero, con que nosotros veamos una un smile en sus caras, pues ya sabes, ese nos paga. Nosotros está más grande que recibir dinero.
Exactamente, muy bien dicho, muy bien dicho. Pues sobre todo, como digo, reitero mis felicidades a ustedes y quiero también, bueno, reconociendo sus esfuerzos, porque como siempre digo, cualquier persona que sale y hace trabajo por voluntarismo merece de la atención y merece de mis respetos, porque hoy en día eso carece.
Y en las actividades no solo se está llevando a cabo aquí en Orange Rock, en todos los distritos en Boys está teniendo actividades.
Así que para no solo en Orange Rock, sino por todo el país.
Sí, estoy al tanto de ello, les pedí que hagan, ¿no?, algo, y están, todos están preparando actividades en cada distrito.
Me alegro.
Cada
eso.
Distrito.
Me alegro.
Y eso. Estamos trabajando juntamente con NCE, National Council of Agents. Y otras organizaciones que hicimos partnership para estar trabajando. Okay. Pues gracias a Dios que todo nos está yendo bien, aunque hay tropezones, como dicen, pero siempre el Señor no nos abandona, siempre salimos adelante. Como ayer yo salí todo el día, anduve dando las invitaciones a los ancianos y todo, y explicándoles qué es lo que va a haber y todo, y viendo nuestras miembros, y ahí estoy todo el día, que hasta las 7 de la noche entré a la casa. Me canso, pero al final del día me siento contenta, porque sé que estoy llevando a cabo lo que le pedí al Señor que me bendiga para que yo haga. Y gracias a Dios, su bendición nunca me abandona.
Pues ojalá haya más.
Y gracias a los negocios que pues me están ayudando en esta ocasión. Ya conseguí, bueno, solo pedí a 3 negocios, pues 2 ya me contestaron, ya conseguí lo que les había pedido. Es que solo uno me hace falta, que al rato voy a ir a chequearlo. Pero gracias
muy
a Dios.
Muy bien, señora Raimunda, muy bien. Yo, como de nuevo les repito que yo quiero decir de corazón, les deseo todo lo mejor en sus esfuerzos.
Y también quisiera invitar a Mr. Chequillo, Mr. Dilun, que puede llegar hoy en la tarde para ver el church service que vamos a tener. Y mañana también puede ir a tomar fotos, si quiere. Uh-huh. Ahí, en la misma dirección donde va a ser el church service, ahí va a ser el parque.
Invita él también.
¿Ah?
Invita él también.
Sí. Ah, Mr. Mamón también lo invitaron. Sí, él ya está rumbo a ser un senior. Él está cordialmente invitado.
Pues le damos las gracias de nuevo. Okay. Le damos las gracias de nuevo y sobre todo nuestras felicidades con nuestros mejores deseos. Para todo lo que están haciendo, que tengan mucho éxito. Y a ustedes, señores y señoras, jóvenes en particular, nunca le pierdan el respeto a un anciano, una persona de mayor edad, no anciana por decir, de mayor edad, y a una persona más grande, no más viejo, más grande que tú. ¿Okay?
Así es.
Sobre todo, merecen de tu respeto. Lo han ganado, lo meritan.
Sí,
y
porque
si es que tú puedes hacer algo para cambiar sus vidas, su vida. Y por el amor de Dios, si tienes abuelos y bisabuelos vivos, visítalos.
Sí, porque yo tengo esa creencia que este país fue fundado por nuestros antepasados que fueron ancianos. Uh-huh. Y por medio de eso nosotros estamos aquí en este mundo. Y yo creo que todo el país, hasta el gobierno, debe de honrar a todo anciano, todo senior citizen que hay sobre esta tierra.
Exactamente.
Y yo creo, le pido al gobierno, al primer ministro, que nos escuche, que él piense que nosotros necesitamos un fondos para que podamos seguir trabajando. Alegremente sacamos de nuestra bolsa, pero también a veces hay que ver que no tenemos trabajo, muchos problemas, muchos tropiezos que no podemos conseguir lo que realmente queremos. Pero si el gobierno nos ayuda con un deep funding que digamos especialmente para ayudar a los ancianos, iba a estar un alegre. Como dicen, ahorita vemos que hay bastantes strikes, que hay bastantes demostraciones. Pues yo creo, a veces digo, pues Yo creo que Boyce debe de tener una demostración para ir con el gobierno para ver qué podemos hacer. Pero gracias a Dios, no hemos,
como dice,
no hemos
todos,
llegado a
Dios provee para todos.
Así sí. es. Así
les doy las gracias, compañeros, y les deseo de nuevo todo lo mejor. Vamos a una pausa, porque ya tenemos al otro invitado en el estudio, dándole gracias de nuevo a la participación de esas dos personas con esas felicidades y con esos mejores deseos.
Oh, y disculpe, quisiera darle las gracias al ministro, Mr. Aragón, porque él también nos está ayudando bastante. Cada que necesitamos una ayuda, ahí corremos con él y él siempre está dispuesto a ayudarnos.
Pues muy bien dicho.
Y el último actividad también que tenemos es que por favor traten de, si pueden y si quieren y si les nace del corazón, usar una camisa amarillo el día de mañana, todo así. El día, porque es el color que usamos para los santos.
Mañana todos vestidos de amarillo.
Sí. Sí, y le pedimos a todos los...
Ahí también yo voy a anticipar.
A todos los negocios, sí. Todos los de allá afuera, los trabajadores que nos acompañen en esta ocasión para honrar a nuestros ancianos. Que usen una camisa o una blusa amarillo el día de hoy y mañana.
Para mostrar tu solidaridad sí. con toda sí. la gente de mayor edad.
Sí, así es.
Okay. Bueno. Pues gracias señores. Vamos a esta pausa, pero regresamos con ustedes tan pronto dos anuncios comerciales.
Already a hotspot for commercial activities, entertainment, and recreation, Belize City will have a massive upgrade with the construction of the $30 million Belize City Center multi-purpose facility by the government of Belize.
The idea is that it will be a multi-purpose facility with the emphasis on court sports for the country, but with the ability to branch out, of course, into entertainment and other cultural venues that we would like to see happen within the city of Belize and to also promote throughout the country of Belize other entertainment.
Upon completion, the facility will have 4,500 individually molded seats, 3 wooden courts, 4 locker rooms, and many other new and exciting amenities for sports and entertainment. The government of Belize is committed to the infrastructural development of not only our cities, but of our country. Your vision, our mission.
The Barrow administration has put mechanisms in place to weed out wrongdoing in the immigration department. But let us examine what occurred during the PUP tenure. When in September 22, 1992, the permanent secretary in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs was instructed by Syed Musa to write to the Director of Immigration and approve 254 nationality certificates with no oversight, waiving all fees. The certificates bore no photograph of the applicant, and there was no record of swearing in, an oath having been taken. In several other instances, Syed Musa was written to requesting the waiver of the procedures and fees of many persons applying for nationality. They gave away millions of dollars in revenue belonging to the government of Belize. Julius Espat says police beat him up during the incident that he caused at the house meeting.
I've gotten beaten up by the police forces. Someone here beat me up, that cool, and they beat me up.
He even filled out a medical report for the police. But, lucky for us, he didn't know what all was caught on tape. Damn! Is Julius telling the truth? You be the judge.
DigiFans get more, so much more. And when you're a DigiFan with a combo plan, everyone talks free. Free nights, free weekends, more data on the country's largest 4G network, and the best call rates as low as 9 cents a minute. They get more ways to show who they are in more places on more phones. And with the most affordable plans in the country, they get it for less. Be a DigiFan. Get more.
I'm a DigiFan.
I'm a DigiFan.
I'm a DigiFan.
Because I get more.
Because I get more.
Because I get more.
Always more with Digicel.
Expect more, get more.
Always more with Digicel.
Can the accommodation agreement award portion be used to fund government projects? Well, Mr. Man Eamon Courtney, he said no. Make I set the record straight. Out of all the money where the court award for BTL, the biggest amount that for the illegal accommodation agreement where Musa and the PUP they signed. When the government and Ashraf gone to court, the two sides may agree that the money from the accommodation agreement may want put in our charitable trust for fund projects for the Belizean people. But not take my word for it, the director saw in this document we signed, the Telemedia Acquisition Settlement Act. Make I read it for you. The balance shall be applied in accordance with such requests for grants as the government may reasonably make to fund projects to help the people of Belize. That clear as day. Stop listening to people with their power Ashcraft payroll. The record set. Boom!
On Friday, August 26, 2016, one member's behavior brought shame to the entire country.
What is your problem, Mr. Speaker?
They pay you to block me, and that's what they pay you for.
You're gonna tell me? You're
gonna tell me? It's a joke! It's a joke!
Are Julius and the PUP ready to lead?
Sure, but you're asking for rules to be followed elsewhere. You're not following the rules.
You're not following the rules.
When was the last time you got anything free? Well, with Digicel's new improved combo plans, now everyone talks free. With free talk in every plan and even more data for the same low monthly price. I mean, who doesn't love free? Free Sundays with our Lite plan, free weekends with our Plus plan, free nights, weekends, and free calls to your circle with our Elite and Max plans, and even more free 4G data in our Lite, Plus and Elite plans. Don't have a plan? It's easier than ever with low or no deposit for qualifying customers. Still the best plans in the country. Come in and start getting more.
Expect more, get more. Always more with Digicel.
Busta. They see you and know you're living. Busta. Always a star, yes. You live in color to the limit. Busta. Large and in charge, yes. That's why you rock with Busta. Busta. Refreshing range of colorful flavors. Always a star, never the audience. You run things, things never run you. Busta. Yes, you are the life of it, not just a part of it. Your life is never black and white. Live in full color, Busta.
You know your baby is happy when wearing Bebin Pampers. Bebin Pampers. In all sizes. Bebin Pampers make your baby happy. Available at German Vega and Sons.
Mr. Bresenio claims that he wants to imprison anyone named in immigration wrongdoing.
Once we get into government, we are going to go through this, and anybody that can be held criminally liable, we are going to hold them liable. And if they have to go to jail, they are going to go to jail. Enough is enough.
But even your name is there. I saw for recommending a visa. International person. I can't.
I have no
idea. But it's there in the visa one. That's my point. It's in the visa one. I think it's a. I saw it once.
Please show me the pitch.
Are Johnny and the PUP ready to lead?
And welcome back to the Sugar City Morning Show. Bienvenidos de vuelta, compañeros. Hoy hemos tenido el gusto de tener a dos miembros del grupo de la organización Voice, a la señora Raimunda y a la señora Cantún. Y también el gran gusto y más que todo un privilegio de tener al señor ministro Elodio Aragón aquí como nuestro fiel amigo y nuestro fiel apoyante a la causa que tenemos. Señor Aragón, buenos días y bienvenido al show. Estamos pasando por, we're passing through some difficult moments. Difficult in the sense that there is, you know, a lot of upheaval and a lot of demonstrations against. But there must be, at the end of the day, some sort of light at the end of the tunnel, some sort of wise words that come and appease the situation. There must be in this world, there must be that. Given the situation that there is a looming, the possibility looming in the horizon that come next week, Monday, there won't be any classes. At least not that there won't be any classes, correction. The teachers will be going on the strike again. And then possibility that indefinitely it will happen. What has the ministry, what plans does the Ministry of Education have to deal with this situation?
Well, good morning, first of all, to people of Orange Walk and to the people of Belize, no matter where you may be, here in Belize or abroad, no? Good morning. It's a pleasure being here, Emmanuel. And to get right to your question, no? I think that, first of all, we have to make it very clear that the schools countrywide will be open.
Yes.
You know? Yes, there are some teachers that will go on strike, but I just want to inform the public that schools will be open, and a lot of our teachers will be reporting to work. It's not all the teachers that are going on strike. I have spoken to a lot of them personally, and they have said, Mr. Aragon, we are going to teach. Because at the end of the day, the BNTU leadership, it's not fighting for their 3% increase. They are not fighting for what they feel is there to them at this point in time.
They have realized that
they have brought up a number of 8 points that they say they are championing for the teachers in this country. You know, 8 points that they have brought up, which has nothing to do with the 3%. So a lot of teachers have said, you know what, I will not come out and support the BNTU. I will report back to work. And a lot of teachers will do so. And definitely the government has a priority for education. And that priority is to keep schools open and to ensure that education continues for the children. So I want to tell all parents out there, all people who will have their kids out there, to send them to school, because school will be open. And definitely I think the Ministry of Education is putting in certain measures to ensure that there is enough teachers there to carry on with the education of your children. So it is important that you understand that schools will be open, and the Ministry will education will ensure that we can deliver that education.
We
to
have
kids.
Heard in the news yesterday about the possibility of getting temporary teachers.
Right. I think
and an SI. Some sort of regulation, some sort of statutory instrument has to be put in place. So it's the Attorney General's Ministry, along with the Ministry of Education, working together to put in that SI. Is that going to become a reality?
Yes, definitely. I think, you see, we have to understand one thing here, that the BNTU. The strike they are doing, the industrial action. It's they are talking about, oh, this is an industrial action strike but in reality, this is not the teachers. The BNTU union is basically calling a strike not on labor issues, not on labor on a
so
labor
what you're
dispute.
So you're saying that it really does not constitute a labor
exactly
dispute.
Because then a labor dispute is about your pay, is about your conditions of work, right? This is not, and within the law, does not constitute a labor dispute. So when BNTU calls for industrial action and then went on strike, etc., there's no substance to substantiate that, oh, it's a labor strike. It's about your pay. Now, if it was all about the 3%, then we could understand that. It is not. Right? So basically, their going on strike has nothing to do with the 3%. It has to do with 8 points, which are political agendas. And I tell you, political, and I said it last time, Emmanuel, when you have the BNTU demanding from the Prime Minister and dictating to him and telling him you cannot put such a person as a Minister of Police.
That is what
one of their points is to remove the Minister of Police, which is Mr. Godwin Hulse. Now, how ridiculous is that? The BNTU will direct you. Who is Mr. Godwin Hulse? Has he been a minister that has been irresponsible in terms of managing the police? I don't think so.
In fact, I know it's not.
And I think Mr. Holtz will do a good job there. So how does it comes where BNTU now directs that you as an elected government less than 9 months ago, having gotten a mandate from the people of Belize, you will direct and dictate to the government and telling them who to put
as
minister?
Do you think at the end of the day...
That is not proper.
Let me rephrase that question, because I think it would be unfair to ask you that question. But essentially, let me just personalize it. I think that at a certain point, that the BNTU has lost its way when it comes to, especially with that demand, has lost its way, really.
So the 8 points that they are fighting for has nothing to do to constitute a labor dispute, you know? Those actions, to me, has surpassed the issue of the 3%. They are not interested in that, and it's obvious that the Prime Minister has extended an olive branch, asking them, listen, we need to dialogue more in regard to your 3%. But BNTU is not interested. They have made it quite clear that they are not interested in the 3%, but rather they want to deal with the 8 points. And Prime Minister has sat with them on the last meeting, and to a large extent, about 75% of their demands have been met, and even more by now, because I think the Prime Minister had mentioned to them that even the composition of the Senate Select Committee, he would accede to them their request.
Yes.
And instead of having three UDP senators, he'll have
two. In other words, there has been some amount of flexibility
from the government.
To me that on the other end, the BNTU is unyielding, very, very inflexible, and saying, no, you comply with 100% or nothing. But that's not typically the kind of attitude we find with people, with grown-up people who want to dialogue and try to solve a situation. When it comes to these kind of situations, there has to be a give and take situation.
You have to, and we have to look at it as for what it is. Now, I listened to Mr. Luke Palacio on one of the talk shows, and you know, to me, without a doubt, this has turned into a political, personal agenda of certain people. And when I listen to Luke Palacio and he's saying, well, you know what, when the UDP way back in the last, when they had the demonstrations, you know, he mentioned that, let's answer
let's
this
tonight. Sugar City Morning Show, good morning.
Hello, I would like to do a request.
A request?
Can I do a request,
No, I'm sorry, this is a political show at this moment, a segment. Would you like to ask a question to the minister?
I just want to wish a birthday to my mom.
Oh, yeah, sure, man. Go ahead. Talk to me.
They're like, you know. I just want to make you know for you know a birthday today.
Who is it you're wishing happy birthday to?
My mom, Miss Rodelia Kane.
Miss Rodelia Kane. Happy birthday, Miss Rodelia Kane.
Happy birthday, Miss Kane.
Okay?
So getting back to what I was saying is that when I look at Luke Palacio on the show, he was mentioning, well, you know what? The BNTU, we are fighting for the 8 points because this is not about the 3%. They're not interested again. This is about the 8 points, which, as far as I'm concerned, are political, personal agendas of people. They are fighting for country now. It is similar to that of when the UDP, they had demonstrations way back then before the general election where the PUP lost. But I want the public to know that is untrue. That is very untrue. Because
expect
at that time, at that time when they had these demonstrations, it was not only the BNTU that was involved. It was all the other unions, the two other unions. Plus, at that time,
which includes the public PSU and also the PSSL,
it was
right?
Three unions together fighting it out there. It was every single entity out there that was involved. Why? Because at that time, the level of corruption, this is really talk about the Musa administration in terms of the super bond, in terms of the outright scandals, corruption, from all the white, the issues in terms of BTL, the secret accommodation agreement, the Intelco scandal, the selling out of our national assets, all over. You know, utility companies were gone, you know, all the sweetheart deals in terms of the airport, etc. Every single issue. Because at that time, you know, Belize was really in distress, without a doubt, because of what the PUP were doing.
Our foreign reserves went down to as low as maybe $5 or $10 million. And if you ask me right now to tell you what is the current situation with the foreign reserves, they're in excess of $400 right. million.
And apart from that, all the corruption that was at hand, you also had at that time where the POP was basically proposing for a wage freeze, an increment freeze.
Yes, exactly.
You know, so all of these things, when you look at all the corruption that was out there in terms of Los Lagos, Mahogany Heights, Novelos, the ripoff scandal they had there, all of these things was what was at the forefront at that time. And at that time, all the unions came together, everybody out there came together and demonstrated against the government. This scenario is not even close to that scenario. And so when the union leaders brought up and Lou Palacio said, oh, and we have done it before because of that. Well, Mr. Lou Palacio, I'd like to tell you, it's only the BNTU at this point in time who is on your agenda, your personal political agenda. And this is what I want to
teach. Because he's the president.
Yes. And we have to be real. Lou Palacio has run for the POP. You have Mr. Manuel.
I thought he was the previous mayor of Puerto Rico.
And then you have Mr. Fuentes, who is a political person who ran for the PUP in PG. What I'm saying is that some of these most vocal leaders of the BNTU are PUP fanatics. We can't take it away. Mm-hmm. That is a reality.
That's right.
And when now they come and put out to the teachers out there and to the public and say, well, you know, we have done it before because we had to fight for our country at that time. Yes, I agree with you all. We fought for our country. And at that time, but it was totally different. No. Let us not deceive the public and the teachers by saying that made the same thing. It wasn't the same thing. Today, it's only the BNTU fighting. And they fight for 3%. They are fighting for a number of issues, which to me is beyond reasonable. When you fight and tell and dictate to the government that you want the Minister of Police to be replaced, on what grounds? On what grounds? You know, that is uncalled for.
I have a feeling, and I'm very open about it, and I have expressed that feeling already. You see, the PUP carries the unenviable name of being the most corrupt party in history in Belize, like you have mentioned. All the sweetheart deals, all. And as time goes by, we get to find out even more about the corruption like that. But the PUP is not satisfied with that, because as long as they carry that stigma of being the most corrupt party in government, and that's the reason they were voted out in 2008, they feel that they either have to liberate themselves of that guilt tag, or try to put it on somebody else.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what they're trying to do. They're trying to tell the people or convince the people that United Democratic Party, a party in government, is corrupt, even more corrupt or as corrupt as the PUP. Yeah. So the people will say, well, tell you what, this way we cannot justify voting for the PUP because both of them are the same.
Yeah.
What are your views on that?
Well, you know, you see the comparison, they can't compare UDP to POP. Okay. First and foremost, they cannot. Because what is out there in terms of the UDP right now stems a lot from the report of the Accountant General. And that that report will be trashed out at the Senate Select Committee. And the composition of that, the Prime Minister, I think, have acceded to the fact that he's willing to not have the majority in terms of which majority in the first place, because only three, it was going to be seven. Right? And the UDP would have had three senators. The minister will now accede to having only two senators and accede to the request of the BNTU. You see, the Prime Minister is doing his best to try to ensure that he works with the unions. But the unions have made it clear that they are not interested to deal with nothing else but the 8 points, and that they stick and stand firm on the 8 points. Stand firm on 8 points, which to me, no call for them to strike, and no call for them to relinquish their responsibility in terms of teachers coming to work and teaching our kids, right? I don't think that should be necessary. But this is what the BNTU leaders is saying and asking teachers to come out to support, which is an 8 points of things, sure. Which to a large degree, 75% of these things have been dealt with, and I would want to think even more is being achieved, like I told you, in the Prime Minister acceding to the composition of the Senate Select Committee.
If you watch the news yesterday, the government, at least the Minister of Education, was accused, or really questioned, really, not accused, but questioned if what the actions that were being taken by the government was essentially actions that constituted union busting.
You see, yeah, I didn't see the news, but I read the news early this morning, and I'll tell you that I want the public to know, I don't see that as union busting. The government has a responsibility, to ensure that schools remain open so that the education process of our children continues. The union has had all its members, in terms of the BNTU leadership, out there in the public media, telling the people, informing the people, the teachers and the public, of their position, of their stance. It is only fair that the government comes out and educate the teachers likewise of their position, of what is the facts. Because at the end of the time, the most powerful weapon we could have is people who are armed with the proper information to make proper and right decisions. And so I don't see those things as union busting. The government has a job to do. And we must bear in mind that this is not an industrial strike. It is not a, does not call for it's not a labor dispute. It's not about your 3% or conditions or a service or work, you know. This has gone political now. So it doesn't even merit for government to say, well, you know what, then fight for their wages. We have to, this has now gotten political. And therefore, the government must do in its power what it has to do to ensure that classes remain open. And all I think the ministry is doing is ensuring that we can keep our classrooms open, because in a day we need to carry on. And I will tell you, a lot of teachers I've been speaking to in Orange Walk have been telling me that they will be reporting for work. They will be reporting for work, and I applaud them, because definitely they are not getting sidetracked by the BNTU leaders, especially by those fanatic PUP leaders
I saw that the demonstration was going to be clearly drawn on political lines.
Yeah.
Those teachers who are fervent followers of the PUP are going to be the ones waving the flag.
Of course, of course. And like
I
said,
they want to, and let's be real, that's the way it's going to be drawn out. Okay?
Yeah.
And people asking, you know why, you know? That's the way the PUP functions. It places itself in key positions so it can muster the support of the group.
Exactly.
When Monday comes, what is the best advice you can give to the parents out there?
My advice to parents, send your kids to school. Schools will be open. There's no teacher or no principal should be telling teachers that schools will not be open.
Will there be enough teachers to teach?
Definitely, they'll have teachers to teach. I know personally that there's a number of teachers will be reporting for work. A lot of teachers will be reporting for work.
But there will also be teacher recruitment.
Of course. What the government has to do to ensure that we can carry on with the education of our kids.
Let's take the call.
Yeah.
We lost the call. Please call us back again.
Right? So definitely when you look at this, no one should tell anybody that schools will not be open. From the government side, we are informing teachers and parents that schools are open. Teachers should report to school, because this is not where you are. BNTU is calling you to leave your work and go on some strike action. This is not about a labor dispute, which constitutes a lawful authority why you should leave your post as a teacher. It's not about 3% your conditions of service. This is about now a personal political agenda.
So the mandate has been given to the schools to please keep the schools open.
Of course.
What if the schools are closed?
Well, the schools, as far as I know, that is why I think Minister Faba had meetings with all the heads of schools, etc.
Let's get this call. Sugar City Morning Show. Good morning.
Good morning, Emmanuel. Good morning, Minister.
Yeah, good morning.
Morning, this is RC1 here.
Hello, good morning. ¿Cómo estás?
Bien, gracias. Felicidades a todos.
Gracias, igualmente.
I just want to put in my two cents in this situation.
I am sure your two cents come up to big millions of dollars.
Yes, in relation to this BNTU/DOB situation, in a democracy, we admit that part of the democratic process is for people to express themselves through demonstrations or freedom of speech as they so wish. However, this particular case where the BNTU is getting involved now in the political scenario, we need to examine the motives of the leaders of the BNTU, and we also need to inform its members that the primary objective of the BNTU is to look after the welfare of its membership, which are the teachers. In this regard, the 3% negotiation was on the table to be discussed. But from what we understand is that when Luke Palacio went to speak with the Prime Minister, and so he didn't even mention the 3%. He went into his points there that he wants to deal with national issues, and he misled his members to go into political situation. Now, let me explain to you how politics works sometimes. The People's United Party knows that it has no fighting chance of ever getting back in power and in government. So, and they lack resources. Now, they have meetings with their political cronies, leaders in organizations like the president of the BNTU, and said, look, your association has money. You just tell the teachers that, look, we are going to fight for better governance and so, and then you spend the teachers' money to do our political front, and we'll go around and tell people, look, we support you. So we need to examine this situation carefully. Teachers, we know teachers are the pillars of this nation. We respect them. We love the teachers. But teachers also have an obligation to ensure that our students, our children, get the best quality education possible. So let's look at this at a balance now. If the government is saying to a lot of teachers, look, before 2008, Said Musa government put your salaries on freeze, your increments on freeze. Now, with the Barrow administration, yes, they've been getting their increments, they've been getting ways of pay. And I have never heard the president of the BNTU say, right, Honorable Dean Barrow, we want to thank you for what you have been doing for the teachers and their family and their children and their husbands and everything that benefit from this. I have never heard a thank you. All he does is cry against the government. No, we know that we have an extremely loving and reasonable Prime Minister in the Right Honorable Dean Barrow, who says, look, man, let's just have a negotiation. Let's talk about this. And the president of BNTU refuses to talk about the 3%. That is why the other unions are not supporting the BNTU, because they tell the truth to their memberships, where the president of the BNTU does not tell the truth to its members. And it's quite a shame, but I just want to say that this is a political situation, and we want the BNTU president to desist from using the teachers as a political tool for the People's United Party. And I humbly ask the teachers, maintain your professionalism, maintain the respect and dignity that we hold so high for you, and let us together as a community and a nation support you in your efforts, and also ask you kindly, humbly, let's go back to the classrooms. Let's clear up the PSCs. Let's improve them. Let's improve them on the CXCs. Let's have our classrooms competition, as we are the best teachers. We have the best students. Let us motivate this nation into nation building, rather than to have a political leader take away that glory that teachers have for being a political stooge. So parents, teachers, allow the kids to go to school. Teach them. Let's teach them nation building. Let's teach them love for our national anthem, love for our country, and together we're going to have a stronger one. Please, teachers, let's go back to the classroom. I leave it at that.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for that valuable contribution. On the other end of this, complementing that also is what the parents think about sending their kids. Because some parents, even though we're talking openly about telling them, send your kids, they may feel that it is not worth the while, that they're not going to be learning anything, and that there is a certain amount of security risk, because you don't know who is going to, how can you address that situation?
I think the administrators of schools have made it clear that schools will be open as per normal. And they will do whatever it takes to ensure the safety of the kids that go there, and ensure that we are, that the schools are able to impart that education to them. So all I'm telling the parents, send your kids to school. It's a normal school day. You know, yesterday on CTV3, I think I got a little glimpse, and I didn't take much time because I caught the ending of the show, and I thought I saw Mr. Munoz on the talk show. He's the current president of the Orange Walk BNTU here in Orange Walk. And I will tell you, you know, he mentioned some things there which were untrue. He was out there telling people, you know what, school will not be open on Monday.
That's what he said. Is that illegal to say?
Well, you know, they will say what needs to be said because of their personal agenda.
Sugar City Morning Show. Good morning.
Morning. I think it's on by the show.
You are on the show, sir. Go ahead.
Yes, my brother Finnegan, tell me.
Hi, good morning, Minister. How are you doing?
Just calling to say I heard you were in the least of the last night.
Yeah, I heard you were there too. I heard you were there too.
Yes, sir. You hear me there too?
Yes.
I hear you on visiting school, sir.
So what are the results that he gave?
4-2. 4-2, we put a good matchup, a good fight against FC Belize, yes or no?
Did you know?
You're
right. Did very well, I tell you, for a team that has been around for only a month and a half together.
Yeah. You know FC Belize, I'm a team, too?
Yes, that's what I've heard. That's what they told me last night, so I said, what?
All right, good morning.
Good morning, brother.
Yes.
Yeah, he's talking about the game last night between Orange Walk United Football Club
and
FC Belize in Belize.
You still on the line?
So it was a very good game, Emmanuel. You know, they had us one up, and then we came back, we draw that, then they scored again, and we came up 2-2, and that is the way it was. And we proceeded until we lost 4-2. But a very good battle, and you know, FC is right now the leading football club in terms of the PLB right now, in terms of points. And you know, we went up against them. It was not an easy task, but we gave them hell, I tell you. And I am, from watching the game, I am, how would I put it? We could have won that game, but
what can you say? What can you tell in pretty much the same tone in which he called? Because I could see I could sense the little smile in his face as he was calling. Prepare yourself for next year because you might just lose.
No, well, definitely FC Belize has not been given crowned as the champions yet.
Okay.
The season, the tournament is not over.
Okay, but given the good performance that your club has been doing, I mean, the possibilities that it's going to go up.
Of course, it's going up every game. We are playing even better,
okay.
And you know, and it takes time to compete at the Premier League. I believe it's not an easy. That's what the minister calling, trying to
rub it in a little. Yeah. The rubbish minister. That's your winner, that your team.
Yeah, you're good.
And you should be proud
of
it.
And a proud minister supporting FC Belize.
And at the end of the day, perhaps I will do the same thing.
Yeah.
Back to the idea.
Yes, ma'am, but like I was saying, I saw CTV News yesterday, a little bit of it, and I saw Mr. Munoz, who is the leader of the BNTU here in Orange Walk. And we have to be real. You know, Mr. Munoz has his personal agenda to deal with. Everybody knows where he stands on the political line. Right?
Mm-hmm.
He's a POP as far as I'm concerned. And anybody out there could confirm that to me, because that is the reality.
It's common knowledge.
But he was on CTV News yesterday, and he mentioned that he is informing the public that schools will be closed, which is an untruth, because the schools will not be closed.
The Act, the Education Act, quite clearly says that any principal sending out notes or posting on Facebook, I don't know if oral presentations would constitute a threat or constitute going against the law there, but it says that it's completely prohibited for principals or anybody else to say to their classroom, although this does not constitute a legal thing, but with the same scenario, but I mention this because I know of some people who are teachers and advocating pretty much the same
thing. Well, definitely,
but the law prohibits that and says that is going against the law. They have no authority to do
that. You see, like Munoz, there are a number of other teachers who are politically aligned and have their own personal political affiliation in terms of and likings in terms of saying, you know what, we will support, because they know this is a political 8 points that they are fighting for. It's not about we fighting for our conditions of service, our salaries. It's not about that. So, like I mentioned last time, or the last talk show, we have people who are teachers who are political fanatics. And most of these people are the persons who are more vocal. And some of them are people who hold high positions in these schools. You know, and therefore, it's not right for them to say, well, we're not got classes. And so anybody who tells anybody that there's not going to be classes on Monday, like Ms. Munoz telling everybody schools will be closed, is untrue. Schools will be open. So parents, send your kids to school. Teachers, report to work. And I'll tell you, like I mentioned, I've spoken to a lot of teachers out there, and they are saying, Mr. Aragon, you know what? I'm not following with the leadership of BNTU, because this is not about our wage. Our 3%. This is not about our conditions of service, right? This is about their political agenda. And like I mentioned, a lot of those points that were brought up, that have been brought up, and I think it's well aired on Facebook and on the media. If you look at it, you see that these things are political. Yes, some of them are concerns to the public, but they are being dealt with. For instance, the Attorney General's Ministry's report. They have a select Senate committee that will start to meet for the composition, that will draft up the composition of that group tomorrow. And I think Prime Minister has already conceded that, listen, we are just allow for them to have, we will have two persons there. So what else do they want? Their Prime Minister is conceding to many of their stuff there. But yet they are hell-bent on a political agenda and asking for strike. I know, like I mentioned earlier today, having a labor dispute and teachers to go on strike is a normal process. That is part of the regulations in terms of teachers going on strike. But this is not a labor dispute. It doesn't call for industrial action and strike because it is not a labor dispute. You are not fighting for raise of pay, etc. Because that is not even being discussed. And is not the BNTU leadership is not even interested in those things.
But to the contrary, it's pretty much the same spirit that the government offered to increase the 3%. They should be in the same spirit. Say, all right, we are waiting for the 6 months until April.
You know, and apart from that, the Prime Minister said, listen, that is what we should be discussing, to try to look at what we can do to deal with that. I think they brought up something about social security to and from work coverage. Prime Minister said he's willing to look at that and assist with that. But people, the BNTU leadership is not interested in nothing that has to do with the conditions of your service or the increase of the 3%. They have said that is immaterial. They are working and focusing on the 8 points, which to me is some of them, these things are really unreasonable. And some of these points, they're not just for make I say I want it and you'll get it. Some of these things require certain actions for it
to
become
a political party rather than a union.
You know, and then when you have the leaders come out like Munoz yesterday saying, oh, school, no school and they're out there tomorrow, it's wrong. And that is the kind of responsible leader the BNTU leadership has, you know. Right? But they have their personal agenda. And I'll tell you, certain people in our teaching profession are people who are affiliated, and I have no problem with that. You know, if you are affiliated to a political party, that is, to me, not here or there for me. You as a professional should know, listen, maybe I favor PUP or I favor UDP, that's it. Do not let that involve in your professional work that you have to do as a teacher. Keep that out. But some people cannot, and some people bring that and use that to try to sway the schools from opening to ensure and tell people, oh, we're not going to work because we're not there. No, man. If you want to go on strike, that is your personal decision, then go on strike. But do not put barriers in place to prevent schools from opening. No, man.
In terms of the current negotiations between government and the unions, where are we at in terms of, because I saw a leaked letter from the Prime Minister addressed to the three, to the negotiating, what is it, addressed to Mr. Palacio, Mr. Eldred, and Ms. Fraser, Ms. Sharon Fraser. And those were the three key people, because I think one was the president of the BNTU, the other one of the PSU, and the other one of the PSSM, if I have that name correct, okay? But that the Prime Minister was supposedly waiting for an answer from the BNTU in regards to the situation. How are we at this moment? Are we waiting for a response from the BNTU, or do we know that already? Or are we waiting, or should we be looking forward to some sort of appeasement situation from the government?
Well, you know, it's important you bring this up, because I remember last time, I think on one of the newscasts.
Because we can't possibly have this thing looming for the next weeks or so.
I think on
there
one
has
of the,
be closure.
Yeah, on one of the talk shows, they asked, somebody had asked Mr. Luke Palacio, what would it take to bring this one in? Mm-hmm. He said he did not know. He did not know. You fighting for a cause did not know what would it take for this dispute to come to an end. Now, to me, that sounds like somebody who doesn't have no single interest in seeing this.
But yeah, both are unrelenting and very, very trying to bring down a government.
And further, in relation to what you have mentioned, to me, it is Prime Minister is open for dialogue. Uh-huh. He has mentioned that on his message. He has said, listen, I am open to discussion. Dialogue is important, communication is important, but BNTU has said basically to an end, they are going on industrial action, etc. And every time you hear them, it's about what we will do next, what we need to up this thing. They are not interested in fighting for your 3% for the teachers. You know, they're not worried about anything else except their 8 points. And I will tell you this, the 8 points are PUP agenda. Without a doubt, they are PUP agenda. Some of these things, of course, the opposition had some concerns, and we understand that. I mean, we are government. Of course, they will always have issues and stuff. But to the extent for say that, we need for go by industrial action and close down schools and overturn this government, no, man, that's not correct. And some of the demands that are there, you know what? Yes, there are things that has to be looked at. But some of these things will take time for them to become a reality. You can't snap your finger and then today, tomorrow you got the integrity commission form. The integrity commission form, I think, is something good. Prime Minister is open to that. But he's telling me and tells everybody, where is the chartered accountant who is ready to become a politically exposed person?
Do the people know the details of the
people don't understand some of the situations. And I think Luke Palacio in one of the meetings said, well, why we not just change it and make we not have somebody to be a chartered accountant or a politically exposed person? That is not the rules set out by this country. The integrity commission rules are set out from abroad.
From abroad, right.
So we can't just change that and say, well, we don't want this piece, we don't follow that.
Because
and
I think,
and I'm sure if Luke Palacio will find a chartered accountant who is willing to take up that task, mm-hmm. I am sure the Prime Minister is open to name that person as the chair for the Integrity Commission. But these are the things that won't happen overnight.
And I'm sure that you and I, a lot of people out there, will agree that there must be some sort of a further investigation into the Auditor General report, not for what it says, but because as it is, there is no smoking gun evidence in that, you know. But at the end of the day, there must be given some closure as to find out if there were so many wrongdoings per se, well then who was responsible? Was it from within the ministry itself? Was there any sort of, I don't see that it constitutes a criminal charge for a minister to fight for his constituents.
Yeah.
I don't see that. But at the end of the day, if there is really something wrong, well then who did it? And pinpoint, you know, and find out what happened really.
And Emmanuel, and you know, you bring up another important point here. When you look at the Auditor General's report, there's a lot of things that have been mentioned in there, but a lot of things need to be clarified and a lot of things has to be looked at.
Exactly.
Where did the responsibility lie? Who was at fault, etc.? And if you go by the face value of that, then you got Johnny Brissett, your name is mentioned in that,
exactly,
in that report. Like,
because right now they're using,
you know,
it as cast, to cast, spoilers on the ground. See, the auditors, but the auditors general report doesn't say nothing about criminal conduct.
You know the names that are there, you involve a lot of PUPs,
you know?
Likewise, Musa, you have Johnny Brissett, you have a whole series of them there. The fact is that at this point in time, the government has conceded, they have the select Senate committee that will look into this thing, man.
And in terms
and
of
never was the government against,
yes,
a committee to
never
look at this, you know. The only difference at the start was that the Prime Minister believed that it would have been best if a select committee could have looked at it. But they've said, no, we want the Senate select committee. So Prime Minister conceded right away, we're not going to have a problem with that. We do that. They fought now within one of the 8 points. Well, we don't like the composition. We want the composition. These are the Prime Minister's conceded and said, well, if there are two senators, we won't give you that. But the fact is that BNTU is not interested in working and being flexible and reasonable. They are hell-bent because they have their personal political agenda within some of these leaders out there. You know, last time I said it. In all our schools, no matter where we are within this country, in terms of our jobs, you always have people who are politically affiliated. And some of these political affiliations, some of them, especially the PUP, are more vocal. They talk more louder than direct. And a lot of our people who are not PUPs, UDPs, keep quiet. And we're easy to follow. And I'm saying, listen, let that not be the case here. If the PUP fanatics wants to go on strike, let them go on strike. I ask the teachers and those who know and look at this issue clearly, because it's not about your 3%, it's not about your conditions of service, this is about personal political agendas. Let the PUP go out and do their demonstration, if so be the case. But I ask all other teachers, go to work. Go to work, because what the BNTU leadership is trying to get you to go and strike on and not reasons for you to abandon your job, because this is not a labor dispute. This is not about your 3%, which is the key point as far as I concern what is interest to the teachers. There are points on national issues which are being dealt with, you know. So I think that Luke Palacio and are unreasonable, are unflexible. They don't want, the Prime Minister is open and said, come on, let's dialogue. This is for discussion.
Yes,
they have made up their mind. They're not interested. They look at start Monday and then decide how they move from there in terms of trying to shut down the schools, trying to disrupt this government.
Yes.
And I have to remind the people, our Belizean people, less than 9 months ago, you came out and gave this UDP the mandate
to govern
this country, because you know what is UDP and you know what is PUP. At the end of the day, we can never go back to the PUP, not with the leadership that is there. Johnny Briseño, Musa, Fonseca, you name it. We could never go back to them people for what they have done to this country. But in their minds, they feel that for them time they come, because it's been 3 terms. But listen, no Belizean in their right mind will ever go back and put Johnny Briseño there and the PUP back into government because of what they have done. And they are the same architects of corruption in the past and today, the present, and wants to be the future. And that will never happen in the good hearts of all Belizean people. And I'm confident of that. I'm confident of that. So when you look at the UDP, the people, you all came out and voted for the UDP because of the good governance that the UDP has done in the past 2 terms. You have seen all the development we have done in this country. You have seen how we have governed, how we have managed this country in terms of doing our best for our people. You have seen that UDP can't compare to PUP, never. Yes, I'm not going to say we have a perfect government. There's not a perfect government in this world, and if anybody find that, let me know, because maybe I go live there. But we will never have that in this world, as far as I'm concerned. There will always be issues.
Minister, let's take.
And definitely, I want to leave this point with you before we go to break.
Uh-huh.
The mandate for the UDP is to govern. give us a chance to govern. I know, say we don't have issues, you know. We do have issues. And that is why we have the Select Senate Committee to look into the Auditor General's report. We have the Integrity Commission that needs to be set up, and we have to get that done. We have to get all the other things up and running and move on. But it is not...
This is not a magical thing
that the PUP wants you to believe that, oh, everything out of hand, corruption to the extreme. No. A lot of things you read about are falsifications by the PUP in terms of painting a bad picture for the UDP. And we can't allow that, because there's no, in no way is the UDP like the PUP. Never. Just like when Luke Palacio said, and Munoz said, oh, in 2008 when we had the demonstration, it was the same thing. It's not the same thing. Uh-uh. This is only the BNTU going up and saying, we're not interested in 3%, we want to fight for the 8 points, which is politically motivated.
Let's take that break, and we'll be right back with this very... And just to remind you before we go on break, the number to call is 302-2170, or you can send me messages at 635-7436. Let's go on that break.
Let's get ready to rumble!
Get serious. Get bop.
Johnny Briceño and the PUP went to Bamapan to declare all their assets to the National Assembly. But did they declare everything?
Where are those melanias? Those people that did millions of dollars for the Italians and the only
Yes, Johnny, bring back the people's money.
Already a hotspot for commercial activities, entertainment, and recreation, Belize City will have a massive upgrade with the construction of the $30 million Belize City Center multi-purpose facility by the government of Belize.
The idea is that it will be a multi-purpose facility with the emphasis on court sports for the country, but with the ability to branch out, of course, into entertainment and other cultural venues that we would like to see happen within the city of Belize, and to also promote throughout the country of Belize other entertainment.
Upon completion, the facility will have 4,500 individually molded seats, 3 wooden courts, 4 locker rooms, and many other new and exciting amenities for sports and entertainment. The government of Belize is committed to the infrastructural development of not only our cities, but of our country. Your vision, our mission.
The Barrow administration has put mechanisms in place to weed out wrongdoing in the immigration department. But let us examine what occurred during the PUP tenure. When in September 22, 1992, the permanent secretary in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs was instructed by Syed Musa to write to the Director of Immigration and approve 254 nationality certificates with no oversight, waiving all fees. The certificates bore no photograph of the applicant, and there was no record of swearing in, an oath having been taken. In several other instances, Syed Musa was written to requesting the waiver of the procedures and fees of many persons applying for nationality. They gave away millions of dollars in revenue belonging to the government of Belize.
Julius Espat says police beat him up during the incident that he caused at the house meeting.
I've gotten beaten up by the police forces. Someone beat me up that cool and they beat me.
He even filled out a medical report for the police. But, lucky for us, he didn't know what all was caught on tape. Damn! Is Julius telling the truth? You be the judge.
Digi fans get more!
so much more. And when you're a DigiFan with a combo plan, everyone talks free. Free nights, free weekends, more data on the country's largest 4G network, and the best call rates as low as 9 cents a minute. They get more ways to show who they are in more places on more phones. And with the most affordable plans in the country, they get it for less. Be a DigiFan. Get more.
I'm a DigiFan.
I'm a DigiFan.
I'm a DigiFan.
Because I get more.
Because I get more.
Because I get more.
Always more with Digicel.
Expect more, get more. Always more with Digicel.
Can the accommodation agreement award portion be used to fund government projects? Well, Mr. Man, Eamon Courtney, he did say no. Well, make I set the record straight. Out of all the money where the court award for BTL, the biggest amount that for the illegal accommodation agreement where Musa and the PUP they signed. When the government and Ashraf gone to court, the two sides may agree that the money from the accommodation agreement may want put in our charitable trust for fund projects for the Belizean people. But not take my word for it, the director saw in this document we signed, the Telemedia Acquisition Settlement Act. Make a read it for you now. The balance shall be applied in accordance with such requests for grants as the government may reasonably make to fund projects to help the people of Belize. That clear as day. Stop listening to people with their power Ashcraft payroll. The record set. Boom!
On Friday, August 26, 2016, one member's behavior brought shame to the entire country.
What is your problem, Mr. Speaker?
They pay you to block me. And that's what they pay you for.
You're going
to
tell me?
Madam House, you're going to tell me? It's a joke. It's a joke.
Are Julius and the PUP ready to lead?
Sure, but you're asking for rules to be followed elsewhere. You're not following the rules.
You're not following the rules.
When was the last time you got anything free? Well, with Digicel's new improved combo plans, now everyone talks free. With free talk in every plan and even more data for the same low monthly price. I mean, who doesn't love free? Free Sundays with our Lite plan, free weekends with our Plus plan, free nights, weekends, and free calls to your circle with our Elite and Max plans, and even more free 4G data in our Lite, Plus and Elite plans. Don't have a plan? It's easier than ever with low or no deposit for qualifying customers. Still the best plans in the country. Come in and start getting more.
Expect more, get more. Always more with Digicel.
Busta. They see you and know you're living. Always a star, yes. You live in color to the limit. Large and in charge, yes. That's why you rock with Busta. Refreshing range of colorful flavors. Always a star, never the audience. You run things, things never run you. Yes, you are the life of it. Not just a part of it. Your life is never black and white. Live in full color, Busta.
And welcome back to the Sugar City Morning Show. Muy buenos días, compañeros, si nos acabas de sintonizar. Bienvenidos, o bienvenidos de vuelta, si ya estabas sintonizado a nuestro show. Son las 8:50 minutos. It's 10 minutes before 9 o'clock. We had to have go a little break there, the panades break. And we're talking here about the current situation. We're talking here about the looming possibility that come Monday with the teachers, some of the teachers will go on strike beyond what is only Monday, and the possibility that parents will, what will parents do? Will they send their kids to school? Right now we have the Honorable Minister Elodie Aragon, who is telling us the position of this government and the ministry, to send your kids to school, because at the end of the day, schools will be open. And it is illegal for people, or wrong for people, to be saying no classes will there, because we know we'll be teaching. There will be teachers, even if they have to employ temporary teachers.
Definitely, and we have a good cadre of teachers out there. We have retired teachers, good retired teachers who are well knowledgeable. We have people who have their licenses, and of course, there are people who are willing, who can educate, to come out and support the government and schools to ensure that we have employees.
Do you expect some sort of rebuttal from some entities saying, oh, but you were calling for the licensing of our teachers, and all of a sudden you'll be suspending and putting aside all the stringent measures, and all of a sudden you're putting in people who may not fit all the qualifications. But at the end of the day, how do you respond to that?
Well, it's very simple. The teachers, those teachers who walk out and abandon their posts because of political agendas, then we have to fill that gap, and we will find people to come and do the teaching necessary to educate our kids. And I don't see anything wrong with that. Special circumstances require special attention.
Given and the fact, in particular, that it's only for a temporary basis.
Of course. But my thing is simple. You know, I've always stood up for teachers because I think, like Mr. Ruben mentioned, they are the pillars of our society. They do a lot of hard work, I tell you. I come from a family of teachers, so I know.
Your father was a teacher, your mother was a teacher.
Your wife is a teacher,
you know.
So I know the kind of work. But the reality of things is that we have a lot of people, a lot of teachers who are affiliated politically and take and do not know how to separate personal and professional. And in this certain scenario, the PUP is advocating a lot to ensure that there's no school because they have their own political, personal agenda. But I want the Belizean people, and especially the teachers, to know that, listen, we can't fall into that trap. And definitely, we can't fall into that trap with the PUP. I would have been so ashamed for walk with Johnny Briseño, to tell you, if I was a teacher. Who is Johnny Briseño? Who is Musa? Who is the Fonsecas and all the crowd at the PUP there? For me to walk aside them. I would have been to you and I tell you, you know what, PUP, I don't want you to be involved in this what that we are doing. Because they have no scruples, my brother. They wrote the book on corruption.
But it's politically, you know, convenient to say,
yes,
your
it
mask.
Is convenient for the PUP to want to agitate the situation. And BNTU leadership, we have people in there who are PUP fanatics and following and towing the same line of the PUP leadership, Johnny Briseño and the kit of them. Without a doubt, it is obvious. If we look at things objectively, you will find out that it all started about the 3%. And then when the PUP realized that the 3% prime minister, one way or the other, will negotiate and look at it, they switched out that it is not about the 3%, it is for country now, and brought up 8 points, which are, to a large extent, certain issues that are, of course, are of concern, but some of them are based on political agendas, like the removal of the minister dictating to the government that this minister needs to go.
And I'm very glad to hear the minister, you know, remind the man who says, We won the last elections, you know?
Yes.
We won the last elections. In other words, it's a very tactful way of telling you, who the hell do you think you are? We are the ones who are supposed to govern, not you.
Not the BNTU, you know, leadership. But what I'm saying is that teachers, parents, let us not be led astray by the PUP. If you look at everything, look at the thing, familiarize yourself. Now listen to what PUP say. Now look on CTV3. Listen to them, but not listen to them. If you understand me drift. Mm-hmm. Because what CTV3 is doing there is all distortion of lies. When you have one man like Munoz, who should be the leadership, who is the leadership at the BNTU here in Orange Walk, we all know where he stands. He's a political fanatic, without a doubt. He comes and now he goes on the TV and says, nobody, schools will be closed. That is untrue, man. Huh? He has to be real with the Belizean people, and especially people here in Orange Walk. from the mere fact that this thing has shifted will show you that there are political, personal agendas. Mm-hmm. And we can't fall into that. And I want everybody to know. And I ask our UDP teachers, because we have UDP teachers there. Mm-hmm. You know, just like we have PUP, we have UDP. But our UDPs are quiet people. Right? And I ask them, go back to work. And those teachers who are not PUP, UDP, I ask you, listen, go to work. Look at the facts. And nobody have to tell you. Gone are the days where, because somebody knock one pan or say we're going here, we just follow.
You might just
we
follow
have to
blindly.
Think on these things. We have to think on these things. And like I've said, yes, there are little issues there that need to be dealt with in terms of the 8 points, but there's no reason for us to quit on our kids right now. There's no reason for us not to go back to work. The UDP government is dealing with those issues. The biggest scandal that was out there came out as a rise to the Accountant General's report. Yes or no?
Yes.
That is being dealt with the Select Senate, the Select Senate Committee, and the composition that the BNTU leaders were asking, to a large extent, is being conceded to by the Prime Minister. So to a large extent, we deal with that matter. Things like when they ask for a special investigator to come down for the scenario in terms
are
of
you, are you telling me that our police department is
you are telling me that that we need that, and the government is saying and stands on what it says we do not need that. You tell me the DPP office, our police officers are inept. No, man. So those demands, if you look and read on those demands, you will find out that these are politically motivated issues. And the BNTU leadership, like Luke Palacio, Mr. Fuentes, who are political fanatics, and none of them, nobody could tell me they aren't, because I know them. They are the people who are trying to lead you to leave work, to go on a strike action for their own political, personal agendas. And the PUP, Johnny Briceño and others, this is the last straw they have in the series of issues they have had within the last 2 months to cling to. And so this is the last straw, and they will do whatever it takes to finance, to support these kinds of things. And I'll tell you, listen, when you look at it, it's not about your 3%. And in no way has the Prime Minister said that he does not want to discuss and to listen. He is open. But BNTU leadership has made it a point that they are not interested. And these are the points that when you look at it, you tell yourself something is wrong with BNTU leadership. BNTU leadership is there to negotiate, to try to find an amicable resolution to these things. But they are not interested. They are hell-bent on having strike and having the teachers not report to work. So I tell parents out there across this country, send your kids to school. Teachers, come out and teach. Rest assured that the UDP government that you voted, that you have the confidence in because you voted last 9 months for them, for us, I want you to have that confidence that we will deal with the issues. Because at the end of the day, for the last 10 years, the UDP government has done an excellent job, a good job in terms of governing this country. And no government is perfect. And the issues that are there, we are dealing with it. Trust me, we are dealing with it. I think somebody had mentioned, and the Prime Minister had mentioned it, that yes, we're going through a little recession. We have a little hard time. People are saying, whoa, well, POP like say, oh, well, the Petro-Carib money done and this and that. Well, the Petro-Carib money has been used for investments in this country and across this country. The highways that you are riding on, you feel the highways that we are building for this country. You see the infrastructure that is going up and has gone up. So you know where your Petro-Carib dollars have gone to. Yes, we have only had time. Tell me which family doesn't have challenges at home with their budgets. And that you plan for this and plan for that and little issues are there. But at any day, we manage. And that is what a government will do. And if there is ever a government that can get the job done, it is your UDP government. Not the PUP government, you know. PUP government brought us to the brink of devaluation, brink of chaos. And it is the UDP government that restored this Belize to what
stability
it is today.
The economy.
Exactly,
right.
The stability. So I'm asking you through these issues, read it and tell me, is it such that these 8 points are critical to the governance of this country? Yes, there are issues, the Integrity Commission, but there are challenges there. Prime Minister has made that plain and clear. So I'm saying, look at it for what it is, and I am confident that you will understand that what Luke Palacio and people who are politically motivated persons in there are asking you to do, to abandon your jobs, is not right. It's not about no labor dispute again, about your 3%, your conditions of service. It is rather about their own personal political agenda. So think on that, people, think on that. Because at the end of the day, we have our kids to teach. The government has a country to govern, and we need to get on with the work. And yes, Prime Minister has mentioned we are going to go through some little tough time, but listen, tell me which country hasn't gone through those things. But I am confident that with the stewardship of the UDP, we will move and pass through that turbulence and move on to moving this country to become the best it can be. So those are the things that we have to focus on. And I ask the teachers, be objective. Not listen to PUP out there, you know. That's PUP propaganda. That is the PUP are boiling over because Johnny Briceño knows that this is their last straw right now for the time being. And next election, when he feel that it is due to him because they have been out of government for 3 terms, I am confident the Belizean people, when that time comes, will give him the message loud and clear, because that bunch of people can never get back into office, because what they have represented in the past, what they represent now, will never be allowed for them to represent us in the future.
Okay.
You know, so those are the things, Emmanuel, I want to tell the teachers, go back to work. Go back to work, teachers. The government will do its part to ensure that schools remain open. A lot of our teachers are going to work. Do not feel like, oh, nobody under their schools alone, you people. No, we have a lot of our teachers who have told me personally that they will be reporting for work. Okay, so let nobody say that schools won't be open, that you shouldn't send your kids. Your kids will be safe there. There will be everything in place to ensure that school progresses as normal as possible.
Muchas gracias, señor ministro.
Right?
Tenemos una responsabilidad, como siempre digo, nuestra gente de nuestra audiencia latina, que siempre nos recuerda que les gustaría que traduzcamos, y lo he explicado en varias ocasiones, que sería altamente imposible e improbable que tengamos a alguien simplemente traduciendo. Pero cuando tenemos un programa y tenemos el invitado que habla esencialmente de inglés, yo de último hago el esfuerzo de tratar de darte el mensaje en español. La situación, compañeros, en breve, es de que tan pronto el lunes, este lunes, cuando se supone que muchas personas han ido a los medios de comunicación, han estado a la estación de televisión del otro partido y a las radios, diciendo que no va a haber clases, aquí tenemos el ministro Eladio Aragón, que está trabajando también debajo del Ministerio de Educación. Sugar City Morning Show. Good morning. Buenos días.
Good morning. Morning, Minister.
Yeah, morning. Morning.
I think that if we are known at Lucas, I don't say the union again. I say Luke.
Yes, that's well said.
Luke Palacio, they play politics. In this country, it's not like, let's say, for example, boring country like Mexico, Chetamal have nearly a million people, so you could go to one colonia and you find 70,000 people, and then you jump the light and you find another 50,000 people. So there's so many beliefs, small. We have one voters, one teachers, one committee members, just one person is fits so much, we can have a small population. Why the Prime Minister not use a strategy and send out the ministers then if you go see people, because they're the same voters then when the people when they deal. Send out the ministers then launch off our campaigns in the politics look one place and go talk to the people, because the same teachers are the same ones sit down for the political committees there, are the same ones who raise the UDP or the PUP flag, and are the same ones who support the government. So I think if that you want to take it to that level, Like the minister, nothing wrong for making a minister go find out for a teacher this who votes for me, and then I'll find out how many favors ministers has done for teachers and their family on a personal level when it comes to moving forward. And like that, you could find out that the problem could be dealt with, because that's how we look to do it. It separate everybody from the ministers. They're like, it's so hard to make the ministers go back to the people. I think the minister needs to get up and go back to the people there, talk to the teachers, find out how they feel, take it back to the prime minister, and then go from there. Just a suggestion, no? Thank you.
Yes, okay. Well made. Pero estamos hablando tantito en español. Tan pronto el lunes, compañeros, aquí tenemos el comentario del ministro diciendo, padres, manden a sus hijos a la escuela. Va a haber clases. Y si los maestros dicen, yo no voy, que ellos vayan a hacer su demostración, pero ustedes manden a sus hijos a la escuela, porque van a haber maestros. No todos los maestros están en la demostración. Y si aquellos que van, no van a estar ahí, obviamente, van a haber maestros temporales para asistir a enseñar a sus hijos. Porque ustedes se están dando cuenta de la situación. Al final del día, ustedes son los que pueden abrir su boca y decir, ya basta con esto. La razón primordial que eres maestro es para enseñar a nuestros hijos, no para jugarse político.
Right, and at this point in time, we need the teachers to go back to school. I think majority of the teachers have spoken and said, Mr. Aragon, this thing has moved on away from our request as a union for the 3%.
So it's a call to conscience has happened.
Yes, of course, definitely. This, they are seeing it clearly. It's political. From when they had the meeting with the Prime Minister, that same evening they drafted a response, not even coming back to the teachers and explaining to them.
In the meeting or yesterday.
Afterwards and say, well, this is the scenario. You know, all of these things should point to you that, listen, they are not fighting in the interest of the teachers again. You know, they are dragging the teachers into a battle that is political. And that should not be the case. And no union. Or nobody's supposed to use the teachers as a pawn. I don't think that is proper, right? But it is left up to the teachers. And I'll tell you, majority of the teachers that I've spoken to, majority of them will be going to school. And I foresee that school will be open here in Orange Walk. And definitely, the ministry is putting in place measures to ensure that we can continue to provide that education for our kids. So I ask everybody, come out. Aloha, UDP is
over there. I'm a message here,
come
sir,
out and ensure that people
that says that you send your kids to school. Has said that only the gate man will be there, that the school will be closed.
Well, we don't even need to discuss about St. Peter's. If that is the case, I don't know. But I don't think it is proper. All kids need to go to school. But like I've always mentioned, there are people who are politically motivated, have their own personal political agendas.
But should parents take this lightly?
No, definitely not. I think
parents be the one to call the principal and say, I need to send my kid to school, so please, you know, I'm sending my kid to school. What are you going to do?
Right. So
send
your kids to
school. When that happens.
You know, and definitely, you know, I ask teachers to go to school. And those who want to abandon their work, as teachers, you know, it is not proper. It does not fall within the regulations that constitute you as a teacher, that you should be at work. Because it is not about a labor dispute that you are fighting for and you're going to miss work for. You are missing work for a personal political agenda. Because that has nothing to do with your labor issues, and the regulations that govern strikes, etc., has to do with labor. A labor dispute. And we don't have a labor dispute here because it's not about conditions of work.
Is the government first to pay the teachers if they go on demonstration?
Well, you know, I think by regulations, they do not have to pay teachers who do not go to work. Because then you miss work. Which employer pay people when they decide not to go work? Right? So these are the things that I think has to be looked at likewise.
Can you see the morning show?
Hello?
Yes.
Good morning.
I'd like to put a comment on the talk show.
Go ahead. Go ahead, man.
Hello?
Yes, go ahead. Lower the volume of the radio television, please.
Okay.
Go ahead. Go ahead, Carla. You're on the air.
Carla, please go ahead.
Hello?
Go ahead.
Hello?
Please go ahead. Go ahead with your comment.
Yes. We the PI?
Mm-hmm.
Not me.
Go ahead, please.
We the PI stand in solidarity with the teachers because the government is corrupt.
Ah.
We need to stop the corruption.
Mm-hmm.
Which corruption, ma'am?
Can you name me any one minister who is involved in corruption, ma'am?
We need to investigate.
Oh, it seems to me that you're being coerced into this thing, that you're being told what to say. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Did you read that for?
Yeah, I did read it.
Did you read the 8 points there? Yeah.
It's reading.
My thing is simple, you know. Like I've always said, the PUP are boiling over.
Mm-hmm.
I tell you, they're so vile, it is so sad.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I made up on the parade for the September celebrations, and I don't personally hail everybody because, you know, I consider a lot of people friends. And it doesn't matter if you're a PUP or UDP. You know, we have to be mature enough to understand that not everybody can be UDP, not everybody can be PUP. But we have to be respectful of everybody, no matter who you are, PUP or UDP. And that is the kind of person I am, right? And I could hail anybody. And I tell you, I'm at a parade and I hail somebody I know, I always hail. And you know, they nearly beat this man because he healed me back.
I heard you say that, right.
You know, so the sad thing is that we have POP out there who are really violating over. And it's sad, you know, because politics should never get you to be like that, you know. Because at the end of the day, we are all one community, no matter who we are, POP or UDP. And yes, we have differences, and in times we will be separated in terms of either UDP, POP, etc. But at the end of the day, we have to always be able to look above politics for what is best. And at this point in time, there's no way the PUP can tell this nation that the points that that the BNTU leadership is fighting for are such critical points that if they don't get it done, the world will come to an end. No. Or the government will crumble. No. The points that are there, some of these are being addressed. I think Prime Minister has mentioned 75. Right now, at one, let's say 80% of those things have been to a large extent dealt with and are being dealt with. You know, but
so
it is a matter
why
of
is unyielding attitude and
exactly.
Attitude.
And there's still room because the Prime Minister has said we are open for negotiation, discussion, communication. It is up to the unions, but the unions are not interested. They have their own personal political agenda.
And I can understand the
frustration
that the Prime Minister feels because he is being flexible and he's being very given to some finding some sort of solution through dialogue. And then on the other hand, even before you do a presentation to the other side, he already has no written in front of his face.
Yeah.
So, which clearly bespeaks of the political influence that is strong to be felt in that.
And you know, I like to look at things simple. The issue of your 3% for the teachers is not an issue for the BNTU leadership, right?
Mm-hmm.
That is a clear sign that they have no interest for what the teachers, majority of them, are fighting for or interested in. They have brought in a different set of requests, which that should tell you that, listen, they have sidetracked from the true core issues of the teachers. And they gone into now political demands. That political demands, I have no problem when it comes from the PUP, you know, because that is their job as an opposition to come up with these things.
That's
but
right.
When your union will take you on and bring you and lead you
and
into these things,
yeah,
is not
right. One side
because
for days and days.
Those 8 political agendas are what it is, political agendas. And to a lot of it, I know so they have the concerns like the Attorney General's thing, but they are being dealt with through the select Senate committee, through the composition of that board. And when you get things the way you're demanding now that they have a special investigation come up for one murder, when we have had a lot of murders out there, where we have never had no international in person. And you are telling me that for we police office, the detectives and the DPP's office are inept or incompetent? No, man, I don't stand for that. And when you come and direct and tell the government, you need
to fire Mr. Gunnels
from being a minister. That is not your prerogative.
Yeah.
You know?
It's when you're going way beyond yourself.
That is not proper. Huh? And then when you come and be inflexible in issues of the integrity commission, the prime minister don't tell Luke, if you could find one chartered accountant who is ready to become a public political exposed person, then submit his name, we attack that. Luke Palacio can't come up with that. So those are the issues that we have. It's not that prime minister saying you don't want it, you know. But we need to fulfill those posts properly. And we can't change the law because the laws, the regulations that will govern the integrity commission is not made up by Belizeans. Those things come from abroad. So a lot of these things people might not understand, but these are the issues where your leadership from the BNTU union are leading you astray. Look at the issues.
He says, Mr. Manuel Palacio must realize that children's rights to education, I believe, are being violated. After strike, they will be overburdened with homework. Who will defend them? UNICEF?
Yeah. So all I'm telling teachers, listen.
But point well made, point well made, because at the end of the day, to every action, there is a reaction. I believe that if they go for 1 week or so forth, the parents themselves will voice their concern. Or after a couple of days, the parents themselves are going to turn the table and say, ¿Y qué pasó con tu responsabilidad para enseñar? ¿Qué es tu responsabilidad primordial? Sí, yeah, I've given you the chance to demonstrate. Go up and pan, wave your flag, stand before, do anything. Chinks, whatever. And I've done it again, do it again. But please,
you know,
find your place in your classrooms. Teach
yes,
your children.
Uh-huh. Because if you look at things objectively, nobody have to tell you what is what. And let nobody, the first person for come and tell you things, look at who they are and what they stand for.
Mm-hmm.
And at the end of the day, classes, to everybody out there who is listening, classes resume as per normal. Teachers will report.
I'd like to have at least a couple teachers here who are going to school. In fact, we're working on it, and to get their personal views on that. And I'm looking forward to having that, you know, a couple of teachers here. And we're working on that, and they will be expressing their views in terms of this whole situation and why they're going to work and why you should send your kids to school, because these teachers are going back to school to teach on Monday.
That's right.
Guys, it's exactly 19 minutes after 9, and it's that time of the day when we have to say thank you very much for tuning us on. And I want to thank Minister. It's always a pleasure having you here.
My pleasure.
You know, it's always a pleasure. It's you're always welcome to help to collaborate with us, our stories, and try to give you what we perceive as the other side of the story, and to convince you that at the end of the day, the leadership of the BNTU, not the teachers, the leadership of the National Trade Union, Teachers Union, is on a political role. Sorry. And at the end of the day, you know, must follow them with them.
And we are not fighting with the teachers.
And we're not fighting with the teachers.
Right.
So it's exactly 20 minutes after 9. On behalf of Maurice and Cheki and Rahim and all the crew there who is busy eating meat pies, panales and enchiladas and God knows what else, we want to say thank you. We want to say thank you, but we will be here tomorrow again at the usual hour, 7 o'clock in the morning. Please remain tuned tomorrow morning, and we will have a good show. And to today, have a beautiful day. Again, thank you very much. Muchas gracias, compañeros. Recordándoles por último que la sí van a haber clases el lunes. Sí van a ir los maestros a enseñar. Porque no todos van a ir a la campaña política, que creo que es campaña política. Y si aunque esos van, van a haber maestros que van a tomar sus lugares de ellos para asegurarse que tus hijos continúen con su derecho de ser educados. Bueno, compañeros, gracias por la sintonía. Muchas gracias. Nos vemos mañana.